Next up is our speaker from Copenhagen University, Eric. And he's a lecturer and a group leader at the Center for Glycomics. So I'm pretty interested in what this is. I don't know much about it, so I think he'll just present it himself.
Thanks for inviting me. So also thanks for the nice introduction to CRISPR from the previous speaker. And as you now have heard from me, the thing that CRISPR does is make the cuts in the DNA and the cell basically takes care of repairing that cut. So when we entered the field like 5 years ago, working in sequence first, with Taylor and our CRISPRs, we were pretty surprised that all the focus was at optimizing and engineering the tools to get better at cutting. But basically, tools and methods that identify what happens after the cutting were really poorly developed. So basically, the deletions and insertions that CRISPR-Cas generates at the target site were not really efficient methods that in a high throughput manner and a cost-efficient way could determine exactly what happened. So is it one base insertion? Is it a 10,000 base deletion? What is actually going on when you throw these gene editing tools on the cell? Now, in many cases, for you that are biotech students, this is not so important because you just want to make an activation of a certain gene, knock it out, and then see the function, the consequence that it has on the cell. But in more challenging applications, such as therapeutics, that was touched on in the previous presentation, it's really important that you know exactly what goes on. So you will actually generate what you're supposed to generate when you throw on these tools. And in many cases, you're getting surprised. So how are we going to evaluate and detect and determine what goes on when we do this genome editing like CRISPR-Cas? This is what I'm going to focus on for the next few slides. So this is basically where we're sitting. We're basically in this little poor building, the old panel, and we're supposed to move. We should have moved, but now we're delayed as usual. I would think that the building is as nice as the new biosustainability building at PCU, but that's a question you can ask yourself. Now, these to the left are the tools that you commonly use in industry, but also in academia. So these are the Simtrix, the Taylors, and the CRISPR. And as presented before, when I go into detail, we generate this double stranded break. And the question is, how do we determine the quality of the break that's been done? How many breaks are being made in a cell population? For instance, in the patient material, if you extract cells from a patient, you throw on the tools, are all the cells being targeted by the tools? Or only a few percent? How do we quantify that? These are questions that are not being really addressed in the field. So this will be a sort of a standard genome editing workflow that you will do in academia, targeting some cells, knocking out a gene. You have different editing tools, same thing as Taylor's CRISPR. You have different ways of delivering the tools to the cells by an RNA delivery platform, a plasmid delivery platform into the cells, by a protein complex with guide RNA, as mentioned before. This probably will be the way that therapeutics will go, with protein because more controlled, or by a viral platform to deliver the CRISPR-Cas to the cells. So then the question is, some of the cells will be targeted, shown in green here, but the majority of the cells will not be affected or take off the genome editing tools. And how do we quantify which ones have been targeted, edited? We've developed a method together with Morten Fabien at the University of Copenhagen where we can select the cells that specifically have been exposed to CRISPR-Cas, so where the genome editing takes place at a higher probability. And you can deselect the ones where there's no editing going on, because those are the cells you're not interested in anyway. And then we developed recently a method where we can exactly quantify in the population of cells or close of cells. Imagine this is patient material. We can go in and directly quantify what happens to the pool of cells when we throw on CRISPR-Cas. So basically, what is not being addressed in the field is the identity of the targeting event. Everyone's been looking at how we cut from CRISPR, taking sequences, but detecting and identification is something that is a little bit obscure in the field. And this we've placed to combine to a pipeline where we can, in a high throughput manner now, cell engineer cells. And this is something that is impressed in Nature Protocols, and you can read the protocols here. And it will devise the protocol to enrich the cells, and also how you can do this in the detection method I'll present to you in the short run. So there are obviously indel detection methods available. The most commonly used is one called enzyme mismatch killing assay. I'll briefly touch upon what it is. And then there's the sequencing-based methods, Sanger sequencing and next-generation sequencing. Extremely powerful, but there are some problems with using these assays. And the main problem is here that from having your sample, you have edited your cells, you have your sample, you have your DNA, then you want to ask what happens, what has happened to the cells. So if you want to do next generation sequencing of Sanger, this takes many days to complete from start to deconvolution of the editing events in the cell, the clone, or whatever you're analyzing. And for the enzyme mismatch killing assay, there's some problems that the sensitivity of the assay is really poor. It's very fast, you can do it in a day, but the sensitivity and identification of the indels is really slow. So I'll present to you a method where we can, within a day, get a complete deconvolution of the editing events in a cell or in cell populations. And we can quantify each individual editing event relative to unmodified alleles or genes in the population of cells. So then you might want to ask why and when do we do this? So why do we want to do this detection of the indels? Now there's a really important note I want to make regarding CRISPR-Cas. And this is sort of exemplified here. The way that you want to purchase the tools, so CRISPR-Cas, the guiding aid, targeting a specific gene, is probably by just going to an algorithm, so go to a company website, and order a few guiding aids that are specific, CRISPR-Cas guiding aids that are specific for the gene of interest. Now, they will all claim that they are validated, those guiding aids, but they're only validated by a bioinformatic algorithm. So the functional efficacy of the guiding aid, you have to test yourself. Regardless of what they state in the catalog, it's validated only by informatic. Experimentally, you then need to show that it actually generates the indels that you want. So if you, for instance, order four guiding aids, or even if you make them yourself, also based on an algorithm that predicts that this is a good site for targeting CRISPR-Cas, you need to experimentally validate that it actually works. And I'll show you that in some cases, actually in many cases, in two-thirds of the cases we've tested, these guiding aids that you buy or make yourself, you've done both, they don't work at all. So it's in particular in a therapeutic setting, you want to know that the guiding aid that you are throwing on a patient material before you return the cells to the patient, you want to know that this guiding aid works. Oh, it doesn't make sense. So depending on the application, this indel detection, quantification, validation of the CRISPR-Cas is very important. So this is the enzyme mismatch killing assay. It's based in the middle here upon that you amplify across the target that you're targeting with CRISPR-Cas, you amplify the PCR product, and the PCR product will be a heterogeneous population of different amplicons with different sizes, depending on the non-homologous end-joining repair mechanism at the cut site. So this heterogeneous population of PCR amplicons, you re-allele, and you throw in the loop-place on it that specifically will cleave the heteroduplex DNA, not the homoduplex DNA, but the heteroduplex DNA. And thus, what you're looking for when you use this assay is a banding pattern. This is without the heteroduplex as well, that indicates that in the population there's something that has happened. You cannot say it's a large lesion, a small lesion, you can only say that something has happened as a consequence of CRISPR-Cas editing. Now what I showed you here is a plot where we know exactly that one allele has, this is a three copy allele system in K562 cells targeting KRAS. So we have three alleles in the cell, in the clone we are looking at here. And we can only say that something has happened, but we cannot say what has happened to either of these alleles. And here we have a heterogeneous population of cells where we have millions of cells that have been exposed to a CRISPR-Cas to target this particular gene from KRAS. And as you can see, the profile in the heterogeneous population, where many different indel events have occurred in the population, the profile looks similar. So you cannot distinguish if this is a heterogeneous population comes from this result or from a clone. This is a problem. then you can turn on to Sanger sequencing by deep sequencing approach, and there you get a defined identification of all the indels in both the clone, that's the clone you're looking at, or heterogeneous population. It's very specific, and it's probably the most sensitive way to detect indels by a deep sequencing approach. Now, another problem, and this is just exemplifying with this mismatched acid problem, there's different nucleases available, so you can, this assay comes in different flavors. It comes as a survey assay, a cell 1 assay, or C7 in the nuclease assay. You can buy the assays in different companies, all based on different nucleases. But as you can see here, I exemplify here a clone where we know there's a 17 base pair deletion on one allele and wild type on the other. And here we have a 10 base pair deletion on one allele. And as you can see, the enzyme mismatch cleavage assay can distinguish and determine that there is an indel in one of these alleles in this particular clone. But here I have an example where we have one base pair deletion on one allele and a normal allele on the other allele. And as you can see, it's difficult to see the normal cell from the genome edited cell that has a single base pair deletion. So the sensitivity of the enzyme is pretty poor. And I will pay attention to this minus one, so small deletions this assay cannot pick up. This is a really important note when you come to using CRISPR-Cas, at least in the mammalian cells. Much of this, what I've been talking about, is derived from mammalian cells. Another problem is that here we have this particular example. You've done the T7 nuclease assay, and you need to factor in the right amount of nuclease, otherwise you completely deteriorate the whole anti-com PCR product. So it's sort of not an easy to do assay because you need to titrate in the right amount of nuclease in order for you to see the patterns that you want to see. There's published some background non-specific activity, which could be a result of this, that you have actually put in too much nuclease into the assay. And there's other issues depending what kind of nuclease you purchase from which vendor you use. If we take this particular example here, we question, well, maybe this is just an agarose gel issue. So it's a technical issue. We cannot separate the one base pair mutant allele from the wild type because we have technical limitations in the agarose gel system we use. So we address that by running it on a Calibre lab chip. It's a company that makes sort of a chip-based assay. As you can see over here, this actually is not able to resolve the issue either. And another vendor has another application on a platform, a computer-based electrophoresis system, a very smart system, but in this case, it's really difficult also to distinguish the mutant from the wild type. So there's some issues with this particular assay when it comes to minor indels created by CRISPR-Cas, for instance. So sequencing, this is probably the most preferred and commonly used, but it has some problems. First of all, Sanger sequencing, nobody does Sanger sequencing anymore. All the sequencers are stored away in the storage room because everybody's just shipping it out. So you outsource the sequencing, you take your DNA sample, you send it out to a company, and a few days after you get a chromatogram and you can identify what happened. There's different vendors that can be used. Now, next generation sequencing is obviously very powerful. Now, the problem here is the time needed and the labor needed to perform a deep sequencing approach. There's a lot of steps, there's a lot of quality control steps, and last but not least, there's a whole data analysis. So imagine you're getting these millions of reads that derive from the sample that you genome edited. Then you need some statistician that can deconvolute what all this means. So the whole data analysis package downstream takes time, days maybe, in order for you to get to the right result, which is what actually happens after CRISPR-Cas targeting. So in this case, deterministic sequencing, it will take weeks. In our hands, and we are fairly good at the deep sequencing, but we cannot complete it within at least 5 days. Now, in many cases, this may not be so important, but in certain applications, time is really an issue, in particular in therapeutic applications of genome editing. So, basically, the preferred method, and probably the method that you will encounter during your studies, will be the enzyme mismatch cleavage assay. And lo and behold, we still see publications in high impact journals where they rely on this cleavage assay. Basically, it's a really sloppy assay, and I am surprised that people can get away with that. And I think it's the reason is that it's very famous people publishing, and everybody thinks that if they can do it, that must be the right way. So sort of a herd effect thing, lemming effect in Danish, that because they are doing, we will do it also, without thinking maybe there's a better way of doing that. And we thought about that, and basically turned back to the sequenator stored away in the storage rooms. And we basically brushed it off, refurbished it, and the reason is that the sequenator has a one base pair discrimination power. This is how we design a sequence, because we can discriminate single base differences in fragments. In this case, profiled in a capillary electrophoric system, but the amplicon or the fragments in this case from the Sanger sequence need to be profile labeled. Then a laser will detect as they root out from the capillary the different sizes of fragments of your sequencing reaction. Now, young in the laboratory, we went to the sequenator and thought, can we in some way profile label the PCR amplicons that are being amplified across the CRISPR-Cas target locus? So we came up with a fairly interesting idea that if we have a three-prime system where you have your normal forward and reverse-going primers, but at the forward-going prime you have an extension that encodes the template sequence for a universal fluorophore label primer. So by titrating the right concentrations, this is all published in Nature and Nucleic Acid Research, you will be able to fluorophore label the PCR product basically. Having done that, you just simply need to apply to the sequenator, and the sequenator will do the rest and discriminate by single base pair discrimination power the fragment sizes from the pool of amplicons derived after CRISPR-Cas targeting. This is basically what we did. This is just an example. So what you will see in the following slides is chromatograms, where we indicate the wild-type allele with an allele that CRISPR-Cas is not targeted in the pool cells, for instance. And over here you see to the right insertions, and as you note, the insertions is one insertion, a single base pair insertion. To the left we see deletions, and these are minus 1, 2, 3, going down to whatever deletions you have in your combination of cells. And you can quantify this based on the error on the P, so you can get a relative value of how frequent in the pool of cells do we see minus 1, plus 1, and so forth. Really powerful. And this is basically the workhorse in the whole assay, this fluorophore label primer that makes and allows for fluorophore labeling of the PCR products. Now this is an example from the previous slide where we have this sloppy assay, minus one base pair deletion, poorly discriminated for by the enzymatic cleavage assay, and when we run the IDA assay, as it's called indel detection by amplicon analysis, we can see very nice discrimination between the one base pair allele and the wild type allele. In the clone. Again, here we have this pool and the clone. They look similar by the enzymatic cleavage assay, and they very nicely discriminate that we have all three alleles represented with different deletions on either allele as a consequence of CRISPR-Cas targeting. And here we have the pool cells where we have all these different deletions represented from different cells in the population with different deletions in the closed population of the cells. Now, we then question, well, can we, as I showed you before, the guiding aid that you make yourself, this is an example where we make ourselves, or you purchase, we need to validate if they work. So we have a very nice experiment, or a setup, where we actually have, and it's not so important, but we have in green a 5-4 antibody that only will react if we have efficient targeting of the cells. So we have sort of a readout, a control, where we could refer to the IDA assay, the profile against the biomarker as control assay. And this is the example. It turned out that when we throw on the guideline number 2, we see green cells as indicated by the reactivity with the antibody, whereas in this case with guideline number 1, we had very poor, a few green cells colored, and in two cases we had hardly, this is basically background, we had actually no coloring of the cells, indicating that these two designs actually, even though they target at a similar locus, in this case the CHO cells, they did actually not give rise to any CRISPR-Cas
deletions in the E cells.
Now then we're on the IDA assay, and as you can see here, this is the control on the top, only Cas9 without the guide RNA, nothing happens, we only see the untargeted allele. And here we have the guide RNA number 1 that gave some green fluorescence with the marker. We see that you have the one base pair insertion as the predominant indel event with this particular design, and the guide number 2 gives rise to some deletions, but also more predominantly the one base pair insertion. Which correlates very nicely with the biomarker. And in this case, the two that did not give rise to the green staining of the cells with the biomarker, we cannot see by this assay any indels at all have been generated in the population of cells. Now, then we wanted to compare the power of the assay against sort of the golden standard, vector-based sequencing and Sanger. This is the profile I just showed you before for guide RNA number 2. When we do Sanger sequencing on clones derived from the population cells, we single cell sort them, analyze individual clones for what kind of deletions we see. This is sort of the profile we get, and the profile, as you know, is similar to the profile generated from the IDA assay. When we do next generation sequencing, this is the profile, and this just shows the power or the consequence of doing CRISPR-Cas. This is all the insertions and deletions that you see in population of cells. And you can see it's extremely heterogeneous what actually happens in the cells. It's not a single event, it's different events. This is indel and insertion and deletion. So if we zoom into the most interesting area in this connection here, where we have the untouched allele, the plus one, like here's the predominant one, minus 4, minus 8. So the profile, you could say, from next generation sequencing resembles Sanger and actually resembles the IDA assay. Now this was done on an old sequenator in the basement, so we actually bought a more powerful and newer version of the sequenator from Applied Biosystems and repeated the experiment basically 1.5 years after. This is the old experiment up to the left. And on the new machine, you can see the profile, the dynamic range is much more is superior to the old version. If we look into the area here where there's actually not much going on, when we blow up the window, we zoom in to see the rare indel events. Can we say anything about those? Yes, we can. So if we zoom into the rarely occurring ones, these are the frequently occurring ones, so 6, 7, and 8 have been highlighted. These are sort of the very rarely, they only come in a few sub-percentage frequencies in the population of cells. And compare the pattern again to next generation sequencing. So this is the next generation sequencing profile. And if you can see here the pattern of the lowly occurring indels from the IDA assay and the next generation sequencing assay, they are very, very similar. You can quantify this, the sort of the frequency of the rarely occurring relative to the untouched allele. And you can come up with numbers where we can say that the next generation sequencing indel detection sensitivity is similar to the IDA assay or the other way around. Around 0.1%, not so important in this context, but this is actually an interesting point because others have published that the sensitivity of next generation sequencing in fact is in the range of 0.1%. You can question whether CRISPR-Cas as such or the assay also is reproducible. We've addressed this for CRISPR-Cas with two different guide RNAs targeting two different genes, two different experiments. A, the number one and number two are two independent experiments done two different dates with the same guide RNA, same cells. And as you can see, the profile generated in this IDA assay are very similar, indicating that the experimental variation is highly reproducible when you do CRISPR-Cas. So if you take the tools day one, you want to repeat the experiment after the review has shut down the manuscript and wants you to reproduce the data, you can take the same guide RNA and you will generate the same data. Another example to the right, example B, another target, also very similar profiles in the same cell line. We take the same guide RNA, we are holding B panel here in H293 cells, another favorite cell line, and we see that the guide RNAs give very reproducible results. But the profile generated with the same RNA in different cells is slightly different. So they're not identical, probably a result of that the repair capacity in different cell lines is different and therefore gives rise to different indels and insertions and deletions.
depending on the capacity of the repair apparatus in the cell. So, what is this with this CRISPR Cas and the one base pair insertion? Now, 2 years ago, I was at a genome editing meeting and I met Horizon, which is one of the sort of the suppliers in the field of services in regards to CRISPR Cas. And they have sequenced thousands of experimental systems where they target with different CRISPR Cas RNAs and deep sequence to identify the insertions and deletions that they generate in these thousands of different experiments. And what they know was that the one base pair insertion is the single most frequently occurring indel that they see up in CRISPR-Cas. Up to 30% of the incidents when you throw on CRISPR-Cas will generate a one base pair cluster one base pair insertion, at least in the main cells. Now this is sort of interesting if you have a system like the enzymatic cleavage assay that is unable to identify minor deletions, you will miss these events in the population of cells. So if you have a situation where you have a therapeutic approach where you want to determine exactly what's going on with the patient cells, you'll miss these events and get a false negative result, basically, that you will conclude with regard to if these cells are appropriate to return to a patient or not. This has also been backed up in a recent publication by the Dalton group in Berkeley. But they also see that the plus one base pair insertion, this is the ATCG distribution on the plus one base pair insertion as the most frequently occurring, and this is two different RNAs. Also by deep sequencing, they see the plus one as a very frequently occurring indel as a consequence of CRISPR-Cas. So, in the laboratory, how are you going to validate your RNAs for whether they work? Now, this is sort of the publication that Morten and I have in protocols and press, where we sort of combine the IDA assay with facts enrichment of the cells that have been exposed to CRISPR-Cas in this case. So you can sort the cells by facts, so we divide them into two populations, throw out the ones that have not been targeted, the ones shown in white, and the green ones you want to analyze by this assay. If we take the assay, again, the four guidelines that I started to start my presentation by illustrating will have different efficacies in cutting at the target site. You can see here, number 1, and number 4, based on the guide assay, give rise to very little cutting, whereas number 2 and 3 seem to be cutting at a fairly efficient level in these two cases. Now you may question, well, is this dependent on the transfection efficiency? So the percentage of CRISPR-Cas tools that come into the cells, so you could argue here very few of the molecules that come into the cell, here very many. You can quantify this by facts and show that the transfection efficiency, so the ability for the cells to take up the tools, is similar in all four cases. So it's not an issue of that the tools have not entered the cell, it's an issue that the tools that enter the cell actually don't work. And if you enrich so sort for the cells that have been exposed to the CRISPR-Cas, you can see very prominent in those cells where the guidelines by the one sort of example show to work, they work very nicely if you enrich for those populations that have been exposed to CRISPR-Cas. The ones where we could see no effect in those sort of cells, even if you enrich, you cannot improve the efficacy of the tool. So this just highlights that it's really important for you to determine whether they work or not before you enter an exalted experiment in the beginning of the PhD. Okay, you may ask, well, is this a function that, the fact that a guideline doesn't work, is that a function that of that you are using a cell where it will not work and another cell it might work? Well, we asked that question and we took 3 different cell lines with a guideline and a 3CV doesn't work in one cell line and show that in one cell if it doesn't work there, it will not work in any cell line, at least in an invasive system. So, what I want to basically have as a take-home message is that if you enter this, if you use this assay as an indel detection method, it is extremely simple. It's basically a PCR that takes 2 hours with capillary apheresis, fragment analysis, detection by a sequenator, takes 2 hours. And then you have the profiles that I showed you here that you can sit and browse through to find out where or what samples you want to continue with. So within 6 hours at least, you can have a full spectrum of what's going on after the genome editing experiment. This is sort of a promo, but we actually have an agreement with a company to supply the reagents. So for the tri-farm application for labeling of the amplicons, you can purchase these reagents from CAB Copenhagen. And basically, if you don't have access to a sequenator, because the sequenator is not in the depot room, but it's been thrown away, you can send your fluorophore-labeled PCR product to Eurofins, for instance, and they have a service actually where they, in fact, have an IDA as an option that you can choose. Like for Sanger sequencing, you put in your Dropbox, DNA when you do Sanger, you get the chromatograms back. Here you in the Dropbox, put in your DNA that is fluorophore-labeled, and you get the chromatograms back of how what kind of indels. I have to say, I'm not affiliated with Eurofins, but they thought it was a cool idea, and they took it up, so I don't basically benefit from this at all. Okay, so an overview. We have several different indel detection methods available. There's pros and cons. My main issue here is with phenotypic sequencing that's very popular. It's extremely expensive, it's laborious, and it takes too much time. And what I will not go into details about, but what we are looking at is in the therapeutic window, when you use CRISPR-Cas, you will operate within 2 days from editing your cells to having determined whether you want to return the cells back to the patient. So if you're using next generation sequencing, you cannot get a quality control on whether the editing of the patient cells actually work. But maybe the IDAS could be of help in this case to sort of get a QC on the editing efficacy in a therapeutic setting. I will just lastly address a question that I probably will receive regarding well, these indels that we can profile by this assay, are they a single sequence or are they a heterogeneous population of different, equally sized indel events? So we address that issue together with IET, a supplier of oligonucleotides, and they have a strategy where they complex Cas9 as protein with two independent RNA fragments that represent the guide RNA that was presented in the presentation. But the advantage here is that you can supply the cell up here with just the guide RNA shown in green and orange here. And if you have a cell line that expresses Cas9, this will complex and the editing will happen instantaneously in this particular system. Now, we then deep sequence the population of cells to identify what actually these individual indel peaks represent in regard to sequence composition. And surprisingly, or maybe not so surprisingly, if you first focus on the first star to the right, which is the +1 insertion, we can see that the +1 insertion is not a random event. It doesn't occur anywhere at the cut site. It occurs in a specific position right after the guide RNA sequence, basically, and it's basically only two insertion events that occur at very high frequency. We don't see, for instance, a G or C, but it's very discrete events. So it seems not to be random. Likewise, when we look at the -3 or -9 deletions, you may ask, you may think that, well, these deletions can be all over the place. They're not. Of the -3 indel events, the second star to the left, we see that they are discretely positioned either here or here. They're not here, they're not here, they're not anywhere else, but they're here. So very discreet these events. Likewise for -9, it's not a random event. If it was random, we would see -9 all over the place, giving rise to the same fragment, or that the deletion could sit anywhere. It doesn't. It's two discrete events. So we actually think that CRISPR-Cas induced indel profiles, they are not non-random, or they are non-random, and determined by the repair capacity of the cell. So depending on what cell line you're using and the repair capacity of the cell, it will look like this, or it will look differently, depending on how, the repair capacity of the cell. But this gives rise to that you can use this as sort of a fingerprint of the CRISPR-Cas we are using. So if you want to, again, in a therapeutic setting, go to the authorities and say, and they will ask, do we have control of what's going on? Yes, we do have control, because we know exactly what will occur in the population of cells when we throw in a particular guide RNA in the population of cells. A small, can I say, 5 minutes?
Two.
Perfect. Cool problem here. So we have a lot of applications for the assay, but in one particular example, we were approached by Igor at the Denstent Center, the Monroe Center at the Panama Institute, and they have a problem with highly efficient CRISPR-Cas, not because it doesn't work, but because when you throw in the tools, genetic engineer the fish in this case, they don't, so you have all these fish, 60 fish or whatever, in the aquarium, males and females, but they don't really know how to pick and select the male and the female to efficiently generate F0s to generate an offspring where with a high probability you have the mutant alleles in the fish. So they don't have really a selection criteria for selecting appropriate males and females to generate these very rapidly. And the problem is that, again, the fish people, they're smart, or not so smart, because they will use CRISPR-Cas and they will have, as underlined, a restriction site near the cut site of CRISPR-Cas. So what they're looking for is a CRISPR-Cas site that is in the vicinity of a restriction site. And then they will use the restriction site as an indication for sort of an RFLP restriction fragment that is called morphism assay of the signal for successful targeting when the restriction site is being deleted from the genome. Now, as I've shown you, CRISPR-Cas gives minor deletions, insertion deletions, plus one predominantly. So if you have a restriction site that is situated like there, and the arrow is where the cut site is of CRISPR-Cas, but it generates a plus one insertion, the restriction site is not removed. And this is actually what they see. It's a problem. So here we have an example where in all cases, in all fish that they have analyzed, in this case, not too many, but they have expanded the data set here, the product is cut, indicating that the restriction site has not been touched by CRISPR-Cas. So we asked the question, well, can we use the IDA assay to sort of profile the fish here and select more rationally females and males so we will have high success rate generate the offspring, save time, resources, everything. Maybe the PhD student may be able to complete the PhD if we had an assay like that. And lo and behold, what we show, I'll do very briefly, this is the wild type up on the top. We have a male and a female, and as you can see, these F0s, they're mosaic. So if you take a fin tip and cut it, extract the DNA, there'll be different indel events in the mosaic cells in the fin. But what you can see, there's some indels that are very predominant, occurring in the male and the female. So we tested whether you could predict that these frequently occurring indels would be an indication that these indel events had gone germline. Basically, so the germ cells from the fish, male and female, would also contain these. Thereby, you could use these predominant as an indicator or selection criteria for mating male 1 and 4 in this case. And if you look at the offspring here, different offspring, so this is the title, so we have one, you can see that in the offspring, in this case, we have a nice knockout of both alleles. Wild types completely disappeared. Here we have a knockout also. Here we have a heterogeneous one. So basically what we can say here that you can use the assay to sort of in sort of in the whole animal system, probe and use it as a selection criteria, the readout of the assay as a selection criteria for how you want to mate in a more efficient way. And with these words, I will end and just end up by saying that we think that this assay could be a major benefit. As mentioned before, it doesn't it actually accelerates the whole genome editing profile as we see it. And this could have some applications, particularly in the therapeutic field that have not really touched upon it. So these are the collaborators, these are the group members and some of the collaborators that we are collaborating with regarding application of this particular assay. And I have to mention the more protein that we go for. Of the study that I presented to you
yesterday. Thank you. Thank you. All right, even though you went a little over time, I'll just give you a chance for one question, if anybody sits around and has one. Yeah.
Hi. Thank you for the great talk. This method is mainly developed for the on-target site, right? Like looking at the indels of the on-target site. Can we somehow apply it to detect off dioxide?
Yeah, that's actually why we entered the whole determination of what the detection sensitivity is of the assay. Because it cannot stand alone, but if you deep sequence profile and get an idea of where the off-target sites are, then you know where to look. Then you can use this assay in the population of cells. You go in and target, and specifically look at those sites where we know there's a chance that we have off-target effects. Is there any off-target effects? So yes, we can use the assay to search or determine off-target effects of CRISPR.
Yep, so a very short break, we'll just change the slides and then we'll carry on with the last speaker. So yeah, short break.